Thank you all for giving me some time to talk about memory management in Node.js. How many folks, just a show of hand, come from a Java background or maybe a DevOps background?
Why do you put those two in the same category?
Both of them are dangerous for me, so. And if you answer three questions, it's not a candy, you get a t-shirt.
I have to answer the questions?
Oh, you just ask questions. Oh. That's enough. All right, so myself, I'm Shubhra. I'm in product management at StrongLoop. Doesn't mean much. Just talk, and some guys implement stuff, some doesn't get implemented, but I still talk about it. So here's some guys, if you are looking at who codes Node Core, that's the Node Core team out there, half of them. And the other guys are the guys who maintain Loopback and Express.js. You might be knowing Ben Nudis, Bert Belder, Miroslav. If you use tools like Node Inspector and all, there's code. You know, they are the culprits. Don't call me out. Anyway, we are also contributing about 100 open source projects. And I'm going to use some of the open source projects to go through some of the problems we are trying to solve. Okay, so let's talk about you know, the use case for Node, right? Everybody knows it's an API world, and the sheer number of clients has increased. And what that means is I had one Shubhra today, and tomorrow I have 100 Shubhras. Each of them is not requesting a web page. Everybody is requesting a tiny bit of data, which is going to be a REST or a JSON API, right? And Node is becoming the platform of choice for these APIs. But that being said, the latency demand on these APIs are very uncompromising, right? So it's just a plot of scale. And right now, as you move from the web to the SaaS to the mobile to the IoT space, you'll see that incrementally, like from web to SaaS, it was about 2x latency demand that went up. And now, like if you go to mobile and IoT, it's almost 10x. In terms of latency, you are talking nanoseconds and milliseconds. Now, how are you going to ensure that, right? Hopefully, this is not your app. We don't work at turtle speed. How do we tune performance, right? So that's the whole idea. Anybody here has done a JVM tuning exercise ever? Okay, you guys close your ears. All right, so let's start a little bit at the ground floor, right? I'm going to go as deep as you like. Essentially, there are two ways of managing memory, right? C guys, I used to write C code, and we used to do memory management manually, right? Expensive, malloc, deallocation, housekeeping was a real pain in the ass. But you could control, right? You could control the garbage collection. You could control the memory allocation. All of a sudden, JVMs kicked in, object-oriented programming kicked in, and V8, you know, followed the stream and went for managed memory. When you talk about managed memory, you are essentially dealing with a ruffian who is called the garbage collector, right? What that does, it removes a lot of errors or classes that you might encounter during memory management. However, it takes away that control as well from you, right? So you can't really optimize memory segments within your code itself. And on top of that, the ECMAScript spec essentially makes V8 a black box for you, right? So you can't really, even if you wanted to, you really cannot control the interfaces, right? So how does memory management work today in your case? You keep incrementing a memory pointer and a memory allocation pointer till you get out of memory, and then the GC kicks in, right? And then it's like, I don't know what's happening under the hood. So let's talk about this a little, right? The way garbage collectors work, right, essentially, the whole concept is about reachability. And how do you reach out? You reach out in terms of, there's a specific term called as a GC route. Right, and when we use some of the tooling, I'll tell you how to identify GC routes. And GC routes are reachable or live objects that are in scope of the execution in multiple threads. Now, I'll say, hey, Node doesn't really have threads. That's not necessarily true. You still have the operating context within the POSIX thread, right? Now, what happens is anytime there is an object which is getting called from anywhere in the call stack, right? It could be different execution streams. This could be local variables. This could be global variables that you are using. All of these are kept live in memory. And any object which is referred from a root object is also held back in memory, right? So it's not that you exit the scope of the root object and that object is vanished, right? So where does this happen? Commonly, you look at collection objects like arrays, hash lists, iterators, linked lists. Those are the objects where, you know, from a root object, you might link to it and then you exit the scope, but you have not flushed out the array, right? So that there is a high probability that object will linger in memory. Now, does that necessarily cause a memory leak? Probably not, right? So garbage collection collector, it goes and, you know, it keeps a memory map essentially of all the objects and the pointers to those objects. And after a period of time, there are multiple cycles. It looks at, okay, are these really reachable anymore, or have they timed out? If yes, let's go and clean them up. So it sounds easy. Heck no. So let's go a little bit deeper. Essentially, the way V8 works, it's a pause and stop the world approach, right? However, that being said, like when we say stop the world, it's like halt program execution, go clean up, do a garbage collection cycle, right? But that being said, people say, hey, this is dumb. Why not just, you know, process a part of the heap, clean that up, and still get some of the processing running? Easy to do in multi-threaded environments, extremely difficult to do in case of single-threaded environments like Node, right? But it does keep accurate, you know, pointers, right? So it does not really falsely identify an object or the pointer, or, you know, just cause memory corruption. So if you really look at this, there are two ways, there are two major cycles. Just like in the JVM world, there are two major things that happen. One is called as a short GC, and the second one is called as a full GC. So what is the difference, right? So whenever you, I'm not gonna go into each and every algorithm behind this, but essentially short GC works on something called as scavenging. Okay, you have what we call as a generation space. There is a new space. Anytime you create an object, you essentially are grabbing a chunk of memory and putting it into the new space, right? And this new space looks fast. It's efficient if you are dealing with small chunks of memory. But now you're dealing with physical memory on the system. And when you do that, your space allocation, the space overhead can be large. So it's good. It's fast by design, right? And if you are objects are essentially like a few megabytes, this is the way to go. So what happens is, that's why one of the reasons is when any new object gets created, it's generally put into the new space. And that's where, whenever that object gets dereferenced, a short GC kicks in, goes and cleans that up, right? Now, any object which has been referred for a longer period of time and misses two consecutive short GC cycles, lands up into what we call as the old space, right? And that cannot get collected from there. So what happens is that's where we call something like a full GC that happens. It has different algorithms. There's a mark and sweep, there's a mark compact. I'm not gonna go into that. I wrote a blog about that, feel free to read. Actually, if you Google garbage collection in Node.js, that's the number one link. I think that I'm tired over that. But essentially, you know, in the old space, you are dealing with hundreds of megabytes of data, right? This is all the residual memory that goes and kicks in. But when a full GC kicks in, you are essentially stop the world approach, right? So it's not really optimal. So Google looked about it, and in mid-2012, what essentially happened is they went on to an algorithm called as incremental marking and lazy sweeping, right? So what it does is when you are marking, you know, which objects are unreachable and the roots are not accessible anymore, it marks them in smaller, what I would say, time frequencies of 5 to 10 milliseconds each, right? And then moves on. It doesn't take a big pause. And this is based on a threshold, and memory garbage collection only kicks in when you are above a certain threshold, right? So till that point, it keeps on marking. And then a sweeping process comes up and goes and cleans up all the dead objects. But when the dead objects get cleaned up, they don't necessarily get cleaned up in one sweep shot. Again, it's called lazy sweeping. So it'll say, okay, I'm gonna clear up a set of pages in a group, right? And I'm gonna keep doing that iteratively till I actually clean this up. So you'll see that when you actually watch the heap, you'll always see there are retaining objects in the heap. Doesn't necessarily mean that they haven't got cleaned up by the full GC or the sweeping algorithm there. You should be watching. You need to watch it for a longer period of time and evaluate it. Are those same GC roots getting retained? Make sense? Only then you will be able to really tag whether this is a leaking object or not. Okay. So why do you care? And do you really care? If you're Walmart, you probably do care. They actually had a memory leak, and it took the node core team to figure it out, right? However, I don't, any core developers here? Node core developers? Okay, then you need to pay attention. So how do you actually get to analyze a heap, okay? So first of all, you need to get a hands on a heap dump. So in Java, it's very easy to create a heap dump, right? Kill minus three, there you go. However, there's a module, and you should probably take a note. This module is called as just heap dump. You can npm install that, and you can add that as a require statement at the very beginning of your program. And what you can do is it has a REST API, which is called as write snapshot, okay? And if you do that, that method or that API can actually be called with a sig termination. So you can say kill minus USR2 and pass it the process ID of that running process, and it will automatically go and generate a heap dump for you. Okay. Now that being said, are you going to do this manually all the time? Yeah.
Question on that. Is it stop the world heap dump? I need the application to stop all its.
Well, it's a pause. It's a pause, right? This is a great question. Two more to go.
Other tools to get it out of the core dump as opposed to heap dump?
Yeah, I'll come to that. all right. So, however, that being said, you're not going to be up at 3 a.m. in the night, right, going and trying to write heap snapshots. So make use of the REST API. There are two methodologies. I have pointed this out, right? So if you are looking at what we call as a slow heap memory leak, and you really don't know when it's going to happen, but it happens over a period of a day, right? You can put it on a timer. So you can say, hey, every 30 minutes, go and take a heap snapshot for me, okay? That's how you'll do it, the first one. Now, if you are doing it based on a threshold where you might have a pattern of a suddenly increased memory consumption, maybe memory goes from 100 meg to 350 meg in one snapshot, you don't necessarily know when, and you can't necessarily track it when. In that case, you might use a threshold-based API invocation. Right now here, you can see that I'm watching the memory, and every time the memory consumption grows by 100 meg, I'm going to go and create a heap dump, right? So at the end of the day tomorrow, I come in there, and my production-ready app has like 4 heap dump files to analyze. I have some data to look at, right? All right, so let's look at two patterns. So the first one I mentioned is for this. It's a slow memory leak. You often expect a sawtooth pattern, right? We never really know whether this will go out of memory. And this could also be a function of load, because your heap allocation could grow, right, as your load comes and goes. So you'll actually see a proper curve around that. But traditionally, this is a real memory leak. Often, these are the full GCs that are kicking in, if you take a look at that, right? In case of a rapid memory leak, you'll see a pattern like that. If you are watching simply memory objects, how do you get memory objects? I'm going to tell you that. But if you're putting this on a graph, this is how a rapid memory leak should look like. What's happening here is that you are constantly, your heap memory is going out, up nonstop. However, you're also looking at, slowly looking at a lot of objects creeping in terms of their instance counts, right? So the same number of instances, they are supposed to be garbage collected. But if I watch it maybe for like 10 minutes or 15 minutes, there isn't any significant difference. But if I watch it over an hour or so, I can see that there are instances that are retained back in there. So let's go in and try to do some real-time heap analysis. Anybody who doesn't like to see code? I guess not. Okay, so I have an application here, and What I'm going to do is I'm going to run this. SLC is Strong Loops Runtime Utility. It's totally open source. Feel you to free to use it. And I'm going to say run this on a cluster. Okay, so I'm going to run this application. And I'm going to spin it up on a cluster. And I'm going to just say run it on one process. Right? You could have just run this as Node.js as well. And if I run this, if I'm not using, I can directly go and put in the required statement for the heap dump. But I'm just going to run this as a cluster. And let's say, I'll say SLC run control. This is simple Node.js cluster control, by the way, if you have not used it earlier. And say, OK, so I have a master process and I have a worker process that's listening on that. And what I'm going to do is throw some load at it. Hopefully it doesn't crash my machine again. Create load.js. Okay. Request. Come on. I think it'll complain a couple of times. Okay. Two more. Okay, should be ready to go now. Okay, so I have some load, serious load going on there. And now what I can do is, let's see, status. And I can say SLC run control CP, let's take a heap dump. Heap snapshot. The process, and I'll say first.heap snapshot. Okay, there you go. Okay, wow, that's taking some serious stuff. Okay, so let me actually open this up. Let that take another one. I took like, that's why my machine crashed. I was sitting back and taking some heap snapshots. What I can do is now I can open up simply Chrome DevTools. Anybody who does not use Chrome? No, you won't be in the room. so you can actually use a simple Chrome browser. And you could go and go to your developer console or your JavaScript console. Why is this weird? Yeah.
Click the little top right thing.
Oh, this one?
No, beside the X.
Yeah.
Yeah, yep, that one. Still change Chrome, change it. Right up beside the X. No, beside the X. Beside the X. That one.
Oh, yeah. This one?
Click it, no.
I think this should be okay.
You have to,
I think I got it. No. Okay. So, have you used the profiler, directly the Chrome profiler ever? On the browser side, right? Essentially, you are now taking a snapshot from the server side and porting it out here, okay? So I have to load here. Let's go into this, and I did take some interesting snapshots before I came in. So let's look at some installing memory leaks ones. So this is one heap snapshot. I'm going to load a few more. So second one. This is the third one. Okay. Let's. Yeah, this was a few megs. And I instantaneously took it because I was putting enormous amount of load in there. I could see what the heap consumption would be. But what I'm more interested, rather than the heap consumption, that I can get from any monitoring tool, right? But what I'm more interested are the object inspection within the heap itself. Okay. So if I look at this, oh, come on, make this bigger. Okay, so let's go and sort this guy. Wow, there is something called as a chocolate class. not out of this. It's consuming 22% of the heap. But if I look at the retainers, it's about 4%, right? Let's look at the second one. The dude has jumped up to 77%, and the retainers are up at 30. And that's one of the strategies why you need repeated heap snapshots. And I think this was somewhere in between where it was grown from 22 to 37%, right? So let's pick the one with 77%. And we know chocolate isn't too good for you. So let's go deeper. Oh, what's this? This looks like a constructor. Let's open that up. And there is another one called sugar. That's an array, but why do I have another constructor of the same class referred within that array, within the same constructor? This is never going to end. That looks to be one of my top consumers here. And if I analyze more and more, if you really go through this entire stack, I mocked this up. It's never going to look like this slam dunk in production. But essentially what I did, I threw up a class, put a constructor. Inside that, I created an array, put another reference to the constructor, and spun it in 100 objects, loop of 100 objects every 1 minute, right? So this is going to go up like crazy. And if I now go in, what's interesting to look at is how many objects do I have retained in GC roots, right? So when I say in GC roots, those are the live objects that we just talked about, right? And you need to watch this out over a period of time to really identify how many objects really get into what you call as the old space and even are not getting cleared off from the old space to really identify, okay, in this case, it's slam dunk, it's sugar. But let's look at a real production use case, shall we? So let's...
Dark chocolate sugar.
Pardon?
Dark chocolate.
Okay, so let's look at a real production problem, okay? Anybody heard about Meteor? Okay, they have a distribution environment called as Atmosphere. And that had a memory leak. Number one lesson, don't block the event loop. Who knows how the event loop works here? Anyone? Okay, one or two. Okay, in Java you have threading. In Node you have an event loop. An event loop is essentially an orchestrator process. If you're familiar with middleware, every middleware has an orchestrator. Event loop is your orchestrator. Runs single-threaded, you get all your requests, hands it off to a POSIX thread, remembers the route, okay? Gets back a response of the IO on that POSIX threads, sends it back to the route, to the request, done, right? Sends back the response out. If that guy gets slow, or if you have a condition of a blocked event loop, forget troubleshooting your backend, your Redis, your Mongo, your database, nothing's gonna help. Your system is gonna crash and every user is gonna get booted out, right? This is the use case, okay? What we did was we knew that their memory consumption was abnormally high and we suspected there was a blocked event loop. So we implemented something called as a sampling CPU profiler and we actually created an open source project called as Labs. We might turn into, Ben Nudis is working on turning it into a product called as Watchdog. Should be available in the community. But essentially what it did is whenever it encountered a stalled or a blocked event loop, it triggered a profile. Okay, because normally when you trigger a profile, a CPU profile or a memory profile, very less chances that you're going to get interesting data. Okay, the output of this tool really looks like this, right? Wasn't there too much to it. However, if you just look at this, say, hey, there's a tick callback, which is like close to 100%. But what's more interesting is the first one, where there's a method called as the find or allocate per thread data for this thread, okay, which is taking about 7.3% of your CPU. But why, right? So if you know Meteor's design, they have something, they have implemented something called as Node Fiber, which is pseudo local thread for them, right? The way it works is they use something called as coroutines, right? And what coroutines does for you is it lets you run multiple contexts. It basically tricks V8 to believe, you know, that it's running like multiple, or it's actually running a single process, but it tricks it to believe it's running multiple threads, where it actually does not. Okay, and what it does is each execution context is mapped to a coroutine. And the coroutines are generally loosely mapped. So you can say, hey, a coroutine will run, but it will yield for another coroutine. Once it has finished, simultaneously the other one takes off the control. But both of them can be running in parallel for some amount of time, right? So it almost looks like it's doing some kind of threading, multi-threading, right? So it's essentially what you call, that's the trick. What you do is you are implementing concurrent green threads on a round-robin scheduler. Now, each coroutine has a lot of tiny tasks. There isn't a big blocking tasks for that event loop. So how do you do that, right? So this coroutine implementation uses what you call as a process.nextTick callback, okay? Now, how do we find that out? That's the root cause. Every process.nextTick inbuilt has a fail-safe mechanism. So if you are nearing a condition which is called as max next tick depth, it should go and pass on the control to another event loop execution context, right? But it wasn't doing that. And we increasingly saw that all the calls, all the GC routes were always there in this process.nextTick. What was happening is this is a default setting in Node v10. Okay, but they were using the native MongoDB driver. Anybody uses MongoDB here? Okay, you should know about this. So MongoDB, by default, they had disabled a warning signal that was there. So it was a flag saying, hey, you have reached the max depth of next tick in the processes, right? So because they disabled that, their system never really got a warning. And essentially what happened was as this reached the max tick depth, it just stalled at that point of time, right? So what we did was a single line change, and they paid us handsomely for that. change that from process to next tick to set immediate, and here's your scalability result right out of the box, right? So how did you get to that? The reason we were able to get to that was we were able to isolate that process.nextTick method, which was an ingredient part of the coroutine implementation, as being retained even into the GC routes, even after multiple garbage collection cycles. How did we get to those garbage collection cycles? We triggered profiles. How did we trigger the profiles? We always took that on a conditional basis whenever there was a blocked event loop. Yes?
Let me speak to your question. Another virtual machine does allocation profiling. Can you do allocation profiling in V8?
Not yet. Not yet. That's an interesting one. Like, if you look at implementation, like the newer implementation, anybody heard about io.js here? Okay, I'm bummed. But that being said, you should even look at the Nason project and the avatar.js process. They are trying to do that on the JVM, but essentially it's like every process by itself is running multi-context, but it's essentially getting mocked up like a thread. But you can actually do remote allocation from a central VM manager in the JVM. In a way, it's basically swapping out a big amount of memory and getting it to provision from there.
Oh, I'm sorry, I was talking about
that. Oh, for this use case?
Yeah.
Oh, I see. No, so what was happening is, if I put it in layman terms, Meteor implemented thread local, pseudo thread local. They called it coroutine. And that was, the most used method in there was a method called as process.nextTick, right? But the process.nextTick had reached a maximum depth, the maximum depth of what an event loop can handle on a single execution stream, right? And they turned the warning flag off. The MongoDB native driver guys did that to them, right? And because they turned it off, their system node did not ever know that the depth was reached, so it just stalled there. So essentially, we set it to set immediate. As soon as it triggers, go and pass the request on, the next tick on to our next execution thread instead of stalling there. Did I get your question?
I mean, my next question would be, if that had been set and they had seen it, would they have any way to know
You need to still profile to know, but there won't be any interesting patterns as such, right? And the best way to get a deeper information is when you actually get a blocked event loop. Anything about 20 milliseconds is going to hose up your system. So that's probably the one most important metric to measure in the Node.js ecosystem. Forget browser response, fancy transaction tracing, it's all crap. Just look at the event loop, okay? All right, so I'll...
Gives you an idea around how long the event loop's blocked for?
Yeah, so you have a way of getting the slowest running event loop, and you can also watch the, you can basically watch the max and the min. Rest everything is pretty much averaged out. You can, but the IO is like so intensive. You need like, you know, your overhead for watching that itself will be more than what's worth it, right? But essentially, yeah, you can actually watch every execution context go through the profiler.
Right.
Make sense? Yeah, was there a question? Okay, so let me leave you, like I think we are running out of time. Let me leave you with some code optimization. So we said you can't really do much with the garbage collector as of now, right? But what can you do in terms of code optimization to actually prevent a loop? Anybody heard of a module called as Zone? A few of them, okay. I'm not trying to super promote this because this is not yet too mature. But essentially, it's not built into a Meteor type system where it's using Node 5, but this is built just for regular Express and you know all the ecosystem around that. So if you're really looking at this, what we are trying to implement is it's a way to represent the dynamic execution scope. So what we are doing is also writing a thread local, because unless you have a thread local, you cannot really stitch stuff together. However, what it does, it actually is providing you execution context across the lifecycle. So what happens is, say you encounter something like an error, okay? And on that error, what happens? Your application generally crashes. Even if you do some error handling, you cannot deal with any lingering resources that have been allocated to that execution stream, right? So maybe there was a single error or so. So one of the effective ways, Zones does a bunch more stuff. I'm not gonna get into transaction tracing and error management. What I want to focus is it's a way to group and track resources and errors across asynchronous processes. So how do you do that? So think about this. These are two execution streams or context coming for a single transaction. Zones, if you zonify your application, you can start with a root zone, and then you can zonify every function block in there, and you can use try catches in between. You cannot chain callbacks as of now, but that being said, you essentially are now having something called as a try, a catch, and a finally block. It's not called finally, it's called a zone exit and a zone return. But whenever that block is called, it goes and explicitly will deallocate all the resources, be it memory, CPU, sockets, that had been allocated to that execution stream, which errored out. Make sense? So let's look at a real code example, right? So there are a few of them. So you have something called as a zone complete, so which actually is an indicator of when you are done processing and you are exiting the zone. If you have a zone.throw, you can actually throw that error to a failed state. But because zone is essentially, let me go back here. Because it's a wrapper implementation across your asynchronous callback, and you can have nested zones, you can have a root zone, you can have child zone. I'll show you a code example. What will happen is when you actually throw that error goes and gets captured in that IO wrapper around the JavaScript function. And what happens is this is used for exceptional handling. But if your exception is not caught before the binding layer, the active zone is, it sets itself to a failed state. And what it happens is whenever that flag is set, it goes and starts cleaning up the resources. So before I confuse you a little more, let me show you some code.
How does this relate to domain?
Very close. But I think it's more the multi, I would say, it's essentially was done for more, not just for error handling, but you could also manage the transaction context. As well as you could go and do a lot of inheritance, like you could have sibling zones as well as you could have child zones. And you can even do like try-catch blocks and promises within the zone itself. Does that help you? Okay, let me show you a code example here and then I'll wrap up. So this is, okay, so this is how you actually require a zone. But when you are doing a require a zone, you are just setting up what we call as a root zone, right? It's like a global parameter. However, when you, and you can actually set some flags to it, whether you want long stack support. So if you want to capture a long running error stack trace, right? So it watches the execution context, and maybe you called out three different asynchronous streams, and you got an error in execution stream number one. And you know it can still stitch the entire call stack together for you, right? So that's what long call stack means. So I can see that there is a normal, and you can even share if you are creating an HTTP server or you're creating any resources, you can share that resource within zones. So there are certain rules to follow, like a parent zone. You can share the resources, like a child zone can share the resources of the parent zone, but the parent zone cannot access the resources of a sibling and it cannot access the resources of a child. So, but again, it works upwards, right? So you can actually share them. So let's see here. I've created an HTTP server and I zonified my function, my incoming zone, did some write operations on there. And at the end, I did a zone.return. When I do a zone.return, what it's telling me that all the event emitters that are in play, which are listening in this zone, they would get cleaned up as soon as I exit the scope of this child zone itself. Make sense? There's much more to zones itself, but I just wanted to show you that one piece where you can start to do effective resource management in your code. Although you're never going to go and trigger the GC unless the ECMAScript spec opens up. Right. I think that's pretty much for it. I'll just because Jimmy will kill me, so let me do a quick pitch here. By the way, because we maintain 100 open source projects, we have put another one out there. This is getting a lot of adoption. It's called Strongloop Arc. Whatever I showed you till now was in JavaScript browser and everything. I could have simply launched the Arc product. We have all the Chrome profilers and the heap snapshots, the profiling that we did manually. You can click a button, point at any server, any host, remotely take a heap snapshot, remotely take a profile, load this up here, and analyze that through this, right? So that's part of what we call as the profiler functionality. Plus, we have also added stuff like build and deploy. If you're familiar with projects like PM2 and have, you know, used this for multiple build solutions, we put in a process manager, we put in some metrics. But I think the sweetest part is what we call as the API Composer, which essentially is a big scaffolding using, you know, a bunch of code generators for Express and Loopback framework, which is essentially helping you spin up RESTful APIs in minutes. So take a look, give it a spin, and, you know, give us some feedback. Right?
So your profile now, you can point at any instance?
Yeah, what I did was, like, I went to the server, took a snapshot, looked at a process and did that, and then used up a browser and analyzed that. From here, you can say, hey, I just deployed to an application, and I can watch the four, maybe I provision it to four processes on that server, and I can click that and say, collect a profile remotely. So basically, we had to wire up a channel to transmit the entire profile file over the wire, and it has a built-in analyzer within the tool itself. We essentially skinned the Chrome DevTools here itself, right? It didn't have to reinvent the wheel, but it gives you a very nice visualization how to read those metrics and all. And I think we'll go deeper on this. It's anyway, you know, free for single servers and developers, so give it a spin. I think your life will be much better, right? Cool, that is all. Thank you.